morning, everybody. Thank you so much for being with us here this morning for our worship service. Just a couple of announcements. The National Hmong Caucus was here yesterday, and they did visit with our Hmong congregation. They were here from about 6 to 8:30. So just to let everybody know that, they did go over some of the ministry details of the Hmong ministry here in the United Methodist Church. So I believe that was very helpful. We did have a lot of young couples, probably about 20 of them, along with the kids that were here to listen to the presentation by the National Hmong Caucus. So that was a wonderful thing. It was great to hear them learning more about the United Methodist Church and about how we do our ministry here in the United Methodist Church. So that is a blessing for our church. Just want to let us know that I would like to have a meeting with our worship committee on the 5th of September on Zoom at 6 o'clock. Okay, so that's what I've set it to. If you cannot make that time, please do let me know. I will, I'm flexible with the time and always reschedule it. Just want to read the names of those people who are on the worship committee. We have Jeremy. We also have Aaron and Micah. We have Luis. We have Patty, Jolene, Bill and Sharon, Cheat. We have Janet, Alma, Susan. We've got Aaron again, Aaron Sim, Tyler, Helen, Crystal, Cynthia, and Saul. Okay? And so with that, on the 5th of September. So that's the first Sunday of September. So I would like to have that on Zoom at 6 o'clock. If you're not able to do that, like I said, let me know. And I will change the schedule as whatever it is. Members of the worship committee. Okay, so we have a couple of things I'm going to talk about. But the big thing that I want us to talk about is preparing for our Christmas Eve worship service. I know it's a couple months away, but just want to get ahead of ourselves. Okay? And so are there any other announcements?
Linda's supposed to be here. Well, she may be on her way. We're having a circle tomorrow. Some people are concerned about the smoke in the air. And it's going to be at Jerry's. And it was supposed to be our swimming.
God of grace who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live with rest and peace. Amen. Please turn your hymnals to page 354.
I
Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. May you humble our hearts, Lord. May you open our eyes that we may see you on this day. May you empower us to strengthen us so that we'll be able to surrender our lives over to you, Lord. Just be with us and bless us on this day. May this worship service here bring much glory to you. May this worship service here this morning bring transformation to our lives and change us to be more like your Son, Jesus Christ, on this day. And so we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated at this time, and it is time for our wonderful choir. So I do invite the choir to come over here.
Love Thank you.
Thank you so much for requiring us to have a song. At this time, we'll be hearing our Old Testament reading from Ginger. Come on up, Ginger. Thank you so much, Ginger. At this time, we sing the hymn 369, Blessed Assurance. Please stand with me.
Yeah.
time for us to share our voice of concern as a people. We request this appropriation.
I have a text from Jeannie Long. That's Virginia and Field's daughter, who lives up in Susanville. And her son, Matthew, has been in the hospital, and they've released him to Jeannie and Chet. He is on hospice, and they're going to work with whatever programs they can. She said, you know, he's doing okay, but he is on hospice, so that kind of signals something for most of us. And she's, you know, she just asked for prayers to keep their family in, because she herself has been going through radiation, so it seemed like a lot to bear.
Still the whole packet. Remember, you also pray for the whole lot.
Yes. I've been missing Helen, and I called out there, and we have a COVID.
She's still under.
Yeah.
She's
Lord, thank you so much. Thank you so much for this time of fellowship. Thank you so much for bringing all of us here together to be a part of this church, to be a family here in this community. We pray that you continue to be with us and just let us be the light that shines throughout this entire community. Through us, let us be the church that is able to share your love and grace to the people who are around us at this time. As we also look here within our community, with all the fires that are going on, hearts of the people, all these people who are the victims who have been affected by these fires, Lord, we pray for them and we lift them all up to you. We lift up our church up in Greenville to you. We lift up our members up there in Greenville all up to you. We lift up every resident up there that we will all up to you. What a heartbreaking thing it is, and yet we lift them up to you, knowing, having faith that you will comfort them during this difficult time. Not only that, Lord, we come before you to lift up our brother Rod to you and to you, watch over him. And also lift up our brother Shep to you, also to watch over him. We lift up all of your requests today, and we lift them all up to you on this day. We know that you are a faithful God. We know that you are.
chapter 5, verses 33 through 37. Again, you have heard it that it was said to the people long ago, do not break your oath, but fulfill it to the Lord with the vows you have made. But I tell you, do not swear an oath at all, either by heaven, for it's God's throne, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make even one hair white or black. All you need to say is simply, yes or no. Anything beyond this comes from the evil one. The word of God, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
How many of you remember your vows when you come or became a member of the Baptist Church? Do you? Anybody else? Many of you grew up here in the United Methodist Church, right? Who grew up here in the United Methodist Church? Who grew up in the United Methodist Church? Oh, wow, that's wonderful. I came from the Christian Missionary Alliance Church about 5 to 6 years ago, and so I remember still taking these vows, membership vows when you become a member of the United Methodist Church, and it was actually your pastor, Pastor Chakoa, who was the one that led me to do these vows to become a member of the United Methodist Church. And of course, when we get into the process of becoming a pastor, the candidacy process, and things of that sort, then we also have our own vows that we have to give in front of our DS and the Board of Ordained Ministry. They bring us before the annual conference. We also have more stuff that we need to say, and so forth, and so forth, and so forth, right? And so today what I want to do is, like I said last week, I started this series here talking to us about what it means to be a United Methodist Church, I'm a church member. And so that's why I want to just review these vows for us. But before I review these vows here with us of becoming a United Methodist Church member, is I want us to take a look at the life of Hannah. I don't know how significant you think Hannah's life is. I mean, she's mentioned here in 1 Samuel here in chapter 1 as being the mother of the prophet Samuel. And we see her as she was praying with a lot of anguish. The scripture describes her feeling as being in deep anguish. And the reason for this is because during those difficult days, many, many thousands of years ago, in this culture, you see, a woman that does not have value in their society, in their culture, unless they have children. And so her husband married her, and they were together for 10 years, and she did not have any children at all. So her husband went and took a second wife. And that second wife had many, many children. And so because of that, she felt like she was unworthy in her culture. She felt like she was unworthy during her lifetime in that society where she lived at that time. She felt that the second wife was a much better woman than she was. And she yearned so much just to be loved. She yearned so much just to be valued in that society. And this is what led her to this prayer in front of Eli, the priest at that time. And when she started praying for the son. When Eli saw her, I thought she was going to pray that she was drunk. But we read the scriptures, and we see here that she just didn't have any children. We see here that she wanted so much to have this child, just so she could have this sense of worth, this sense of value in her time, in her culture, in her society at that time. But there's something also in here that is so important for us to realize too. Is that when she prayed for that son, she made a vow to offer that son to God. she made that vow, she promised that, and she kept that vow. She kept that promise before God. And if we were to read the story of Samuel, the calling of Samuel, Samuel was a young boy, we see in the calling of Samuel the condition of the culture at that time, the condition of their society at that time. It was the time, it says that it was the time when there was no vision. It was the time in which the word of the Lord was rare. And so the people of that time, they were far and far away from God. They did not understand. They did not have visions of God. They did not have any divine encounters with the Lord. They did not hear the words from the Lord. The word of the Lord was very, very rare. Because you see, Eli was the priest at that time. And Eli's sons were supposed to take up that role after the death of Eli. But we see, we also see in the story of Samuel that these sons were wicked sons. They were men that were just, and they were just terrible people. When women would come to worship, what would they do? They would sleep with those women. They would bring those women. And you know, this is a terrible, terrible. And so they were not worthy of taking Eli's place. And there was a need. There was a need for someone to take Eli's place at that time. And so that need for the nation of Israel came through Samuel. It was fulfilled through Samuel. And so many times we often talk about Samuel, but we often forget about what happened this month. And it was his mother, this woman who felt so insignificant during her days, during her time, who felt so worthless during her time, it was through her that was actually able, that she was able to bring change to the nation of Israel. She was the one that made it around. It was Samuel. She was the one that offered her son to God. She was the one. She played a major, major role in the history of the Israelites. Even though we would only read this little part about her just being in deep anguish and her praying and offering to God that she would give her child to God. That's what we need to remember also. And even when we are living in times in which we see that there's so much chaos going around, that we can be that. No matter how insignificant we believe we are. Doesn't matter, even if we feel like we're worthless in the society that we are in, that God, that through God, that God can use us. That God can use us to be that change, to change an entire nation. Just as God, what God did here. In which God used this woman, God used heaven. Through heaven, God provided. It was Samuel who was the one who anointed the first king of Israel. And it was Samuel, the son of Hannah, who was the one who anointed King David, the greatest king in the history of the nation of Israel. But all of this would not have been possible if this woman did not cry out. In a time in which there was a lack of spiritual leadership. And during that time, this woman, Hannah, was able to change the history of her people because she put her faith in God. She dared to come for her God to pray. She dared to come for her God to make a vow, to make a promise to her God. And not only did she do that, but she followed through with that vow. She followed through with that oath that she made before God. And so today, there's also a much needed, it is also much needed in our days for people to hear the word of God. And so the world need men and women who are strong in the faith to declare the message of the Lord, to declare the gospel of Jesus Christ. Always say in the United They need Jesus Christ now more than ever. And we may feel that everybody here has already heard about Jesus Christ, right? Many times we feel that. It's been, you know, the church has been going on for 2,000 years, especially here in the West. You know, we've always been a Christian. You know, that's always been our faith. Right? Christianity has always been our faith, the faith that we practice, the traditional faith that we practice. And so many times we often think that everybody has already heard of Jesus Christ, and maybe they don't need to hear about Jesus Christ anymore. But as we look around the world that we are in, as we know, that there is no more, there's just so much of a need for Jesus Christ nowadays. And people just need to know Christ more than ever. I mean, they might have heard about Jesus Christ. They might have heard about the story of Jesus Christ, but what they need to know is they need to know Him for who He is. And that's what the world needs right now, are men and women who are bold enough to stand in the faith, to declare the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we do that first and foremost by taking our vows when we become a member of the church, any church. But we're going to focus on the vows of the United Methodist We take upon that. We take upon that mission of declaring the message of Jesus Christ. Declaring the message of the gospel to the world. To give people hope. We have the greatest gift that God has ever entrusted to anybody. That is the gift that the church has been given, the gift of Jesus Christ to declare to other people. We cannot sit on it, but we need to share it. And we do that first by taking our vows seriously. And so the vows of the United Methodist Church, these vows here are a call to discipleship. When we take these vows, we are promising, we're making our promise that we are going to follow Jesus Christ through the local church, through the United Methodist Church. And it is when we remember these vows, it is when we practice these vows, it is when we live out these vows that we've made. It is through these that we are able to grow as Christians, that we are able to mature in our faith. You see, the Christian faith was never meant for us to just take by ourselves, because all these vows that we make are always vows that are made in the public, in front of the church. Baptism, you know, sometimes people often ask me, Pastor, I want you to baptize me, but I want you to do it privately, and I always tell them, no, it is much better, and it is especially here in the United Methodist Church, that we do our baptism in front of the church, in front of other Christians. Because this is what is going to help us grow. Because, you know, many times when we do these things in private, we oftentimes begin to die. But when we do it in front of the church, when we do it in front of other people, it helps us remember these vows. It helps us remember how serious these vows really are. That they are something that we are to take into our hearts. And they are something that we are to follow, what we are to do. And it's what helps us mature in our faith. Sitting by ourselves, isolating ourselves from other churches, isolating ourselves from other Christians, is never going to help us grow. God has ordained us to be a part of the church. God has never called us to just be individual, you know, just lonely Christians out there, never attending church, never fellowshipping with the church. That is not the way that God planned His kingdom. God has always planned His kingdom for you and I to be a part of a church. And it is through that church, through the struggle of that church, right? Because when you become a part of a church, there's going to be many struggles. There's going to be many conflicts within that church as you're growing up. There's going to be many issues that you're going to face in that church. That is the process of helping us mature in our Christian faith. But if we don't come to church, we just sit at home and we never experience those things, we never grow. We never grow in grace, we never grow in love. But it is through conflict, and it is through these disagreements, and it is through these things, actually, that helps us
truly understand how much God loves us until we understand how much of a struggle God has with us, just as we have with other people. And yet God continues to love us and continues to show grace to us. And so that's the reason why God has chosen the church, this community of the church, for us to be a part of, for us to be a part of Him. That's one of the challenges that we often hear nowadays. Many of our young Christians don't believe in that anymore. That's why we don't see them coming to church anymore. Because we talk so much for so long that it's okay to just be by yourself and you're still a Christian. Yeah, I mean, you can be by yourself and be a Christian, but you're never mature. Because maturity takes place when you're part of something that's just greater than yourself. You're part of a community. It is in that community that your faith grows. It is in that community that you mature in faith. And so these vows are things that for us to take seriously in our lives. And that's the reason why we do it in front of other people, in front of other Christians, so that they can hold us accountable. You see, when you become a member of the United Methodist Church and you take these vows, part of that is to allow the church to hold you accountable. When the church holds you accountable, that helps you grow. And a lot of times we don't like to be held accountable. Right? We don't like that yet. And we can't grow without that. We can't grow without other people holding us accountable. We can't grow without discipline. We can't grow without discipleship. We can't grow without being around other people. But being around other people, you know, one of the things that we often talk about in the United Methodist Church is that we are supposed to love the person that is the most difficult person in the church for you to love. Okay? If I sit around here and see Joe back there, I say, man, Joe is the hardest person for me to get along with, right? But he needs to do what I love the most. That's the United Methodist Church. That's the spirit that we are to have. That we love the person that is the most difficult for us to love. And so the first vow that we take in the United Methodist Church is this: to renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, to reject the evil powers of the world, and to repent of our sin. That is the very first vow that we take. And so this vow is about renouncing sin, it is about resisting evil. And so this vow here addresses the problem of sin and evil in this world. It acknowledges that there are spiritual forces of wickedness. It acknowledges that there are evil powers of this world. It acknowledges these things. And many times we don't want to acknowledge these things anymore. Many times, sometimes we feel that by acknowledging these things that we're being too judgmental, because everybody should just live the life they want to live, and we shouldn't talk about sin anymore and things like that. But when we look at the very first vow that we take, it talks about these spiritual forces of wickedness. It talks about the evil powers of the world. And these are things that we struggle with every day in Ephesians. It talks about these things, that our battle is not against other people. It's not against flesh and bones, but it's against the spiritual forces of this world. And so our first thing is to acknowledge that these things do exist. That there is such a thing as the devil, because the devil is the one that is in charge of these spiritual forces of wickedness. He is the one that is in charge of these evil powers of the world. He and his demons are the ones that are in charge of these systems that tries to lead us into sin, that tries to lead us into chaos, into division, into hatred, into violence, into all these things that are against the will of God. And so we are to acknowledge that these things exist. And not only are we to acknowledge that these things exist, but one of the good things about the United Methodist Church is that we are to be active. We're to be active in speaking out against these things, and working out against these things, and rejecting these things. We're to be active in these things. And so it acknowledges the reality that there is evil in this world. It acknowledges the reality that there is sin in this world. In Proverbs chapter 8, verse 13, it says that the fear of the Lord is hatred of evil. And yet, many times we live like The Word of God says, woe to those who call evil good and good evil. And so, and as Christians, that's not what we are supposed to do. We're not supposed to redefine these things, but we're supposed to understand how God has revealed these things to us. And we're to stand on the Word of God, and we are to reject and renounce these evil forces, these evil powers, and we are to repent from our sins. You see, nowadays, we don't really enforce the idea of repentance anymore. But if we go through the history of the church, the early church, they actually required, they actually demanded for evidence of repentance before they were allowed in the church. If you were an adulterer and you wanted to become a Christian, you would have to leave that life. If you are a drunk and you want to become a Christian, you are to leave that life behind. And it is they believe that it is through the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ that gives us the power to be able to turn away from from the old lifestyle. If you were a thief, you were supposed to show evidence in your life that you have left that life. And so the process to becoming a Christian back in those days was actually a very, very long process. Because they want to disciple you. Make sure you know Jesus Christ. Make sure you receive Jesus Christ in your life. The evidence of you receiving Jesus Christ in your life, that evidence is the power that's been given to you to be able to move away from that life, to be able to leave that life behind. I believe I told this story before a long time ago. One of the big conferences that we have, this South Vietnamese woman, she stood up and she wept. She just wept and she just wept. Before she could speak a word, she just kept weeping. And finally, when she was able to speak a word, this is what she said. She says she celebrates the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because once her husband accepted Jesus Christ into his life, he stopped weeping. You see, back at those many different countries, the idea of being a man is to be a wife. That's the value of being in many cultures and countries they have. And yet this man, when he accepted Jesus Christ, he was able to leave not only his own personal value, but the value of his entire society, his entire culture, and to take upon a new life in Jesus Christ. And this is why so many people value the gospel of Jesus Christ so much because they receive the power. They receive the power of the gospel. Because they see lives being changed. They see other lives. They see their own lives being changed with these things. And so the early church, oftentimes before they were moving into the church, they do require, they do demand that you show repentance in your life, that you're willing to leave this old life here behind. John Wesley himself, he wrote about some of the things that during his days, he was specific about what he called evil. I mean, you wrote a whole list, but I'm just going to share three things with us today. What John Wesley wrote as being evil. The first thing is slavery. Right? Slavery. John Wesley declared that as something that was He also declared the idea of lending money to others at extremely high rates. He declared that as being something that is totally evil, that is not Methodist at all. The third thing he declared was uncharitable conversations. He believed that you can hurt people so much with the words. And so he declared these things as just being absolute evil during his days. Now we can think about our days. Here, the context of our ministry, the context of our community, the context of our time, we can think about what is it nowadays that are evil? What is it that we need to speak out against nowadays? I've listed three things here, and it's pretty obvious, and I'm sure that you have a renounce these things. We need to reject these things. And oftentimes, the first thing that comes to my mind is genocide. And that comes to my mind often because I came from a community that about 50 years ago, that their own government declared genocide on them or on us. And so this word often comes to my mind. I grew up hearing about these stories, about how the wrong community, just about 50 years ago, that allowed them to declare genocide on us. And that's why they had to leave their home. And so I often think about these things. These things are often close to my heart. When I see things like what's going on in Afghanistan, and these people are going out searching for Christians to kill, or other people to kill, that really gets me. Because it's something that I grew up hearing about. These are the story of my parents. Right? My mother, my father lived through very similar situations such as this. My uncle, my parents, my cousins, everybody in my community that I grew up around, they have that very same story. They have very similar stories to what the Afghans are going through nowadays. So these things are things that are close to me. And so when I hear about these things, it hurts me. It's something that touches me. And of course, there's such sexual trafficking. I have this friend on Facebook who, her daughter, 17 years of age, got involved in a sexual trafficking. Oftentimes, in many communities, we often see people bringing these young women from other countries just to the prosecution business and into that form. And when we hear about things like that, when I hear about things like that, it really hurts me. And these are things that we need to talk about. And of course, the main one here is racism. I know that, well, you know, I mean, it's just like the other two, but I mean, the thing that we're really focused on nowadays in our society is racism. Of course, racism is just a new thing. It's hating people just because of the skin or the color. That's something that has been that we are totally against. We need to speak out against these things. And then as we look into the scripture, we see that even John the Baptist spoke about these things. In Luke chapter 3, verse 12 to verse 14, when John the Baptist was baptizing them, and he was addressing the tax collectors, he said to them that you should not allege more than what is required. And the reason why he was calling them to do this is because that was exactly what they were doing. That's how tax collectors at that time, that's how they got rich, because they would allege more than what was necessary, that more than what was required. And they would turn, you know, the government's portion over to them, and they would keep whatever's left over. That's how they became. And John is telling them here that you need to change. You need to repent from this. You need to leave that life behind. And you need to just go back. Just go back to what is required. You don't need to go beyond that. You don't need to cheat people. You need to leave that life behind. And that's the message of repentance when we come to unite with this church. That's the very first thing that we talk about when we come to unite with this church. And we are to replace those old behaviors. We see in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 28, it says that anyone who steals must steal no longer. So we are not going to leave that life behind, but we are supposed to take on a new life. So that's what we'll be talking about next week, is what we'll be talking about taking on that new life. Not only turning away from sin, but we'll be talking about turning toward you. Lord, we thank you so much for your message today. We thank you so much for just helping us as we go through these vows that we take as United Methodist Church members. We pray that you will keep these vows in our hearts, that we will remember these things, but more importantly, Lord, that we will be able to live out these things in our lives, that we will be able to reject the evil powers of this world, that we will have the power to renounce the wickedness of this world, Lord, that we will be able to repent from our sins, that we will turn away.
You stand with me if you're able to. Turn to page 581. Page 581. Lord, whose love for the humble service. God be with you.